This pen is not working right now. Why it is not working? Let me check it out. Okay, got it. Why it was not working? Now it will work. Okay, that's very fine. Okay, so very warm welcome to all of you. So today's topic is Indian judiciary. So when we talk about the term judiciary, judiciary is a place where the people gets justice. And mind you, my dear friends, it is the only place where still justice prevails in India. When the people of the country do not have the trust on the administration, when the people do not have the trust on the police, when the people do not have the trust on the government, they went to the judiciary. And they knows that if they go to the judiciary, there are more than 95% chance that the people are going to get justice. The judiciary in India is something very good, but the only problem in India is that the judicial process in India is very slow. And the judicial process is slow due to obvious reasons, that the population of India is more than 125 crores. But the number of judges looking after the cases are very few, and only 21,000 judges are looking after the cases of 125 crore people. And let me tell you, presently, around 3 crores cases are pending in the Indian courts. It is said a very famous phrase for Indian judiciary that the judiciary in India, the justice in India is delayed, but the justice in India is not denied. Okay. Bharat mein nyay mein der hai, andher nahi hai. Means the judicial process is slow, but the people usually used to get the justice. Although some very important philosophy says that the justice delayed is equivalent to the justice denied. That if you are going to get the justice for after a very long period of time, then there is no value of that justice. And the philosophy says that the justice delayed is equivalent to justice denied. Let me tell you, my dear students, that the judiciary in India is divided into three parts. The judiciary in India is divided into three parts. The first is your Supreme Court. Second is our High Court. And third is the lower courts, also known as the subordinate courts, also known as the district courts, also known as the trial courts, because the cases always begins from this courts only. So the case always begins from the lower court only, and that is why it is also known as a trial court, a subordinate court, or a district court. Let me tell you that, students, that this court in India is known as a trial court because the cases always begins from here only, and the Supreme Court and High Courts are known as the appellate courts. Means you can appeal the cases of lower court in the High Court and the cases of High Court in the Supreme Court. And that is why, let me tell you that the High Court and the Supreme Court are known as appellate courts, because in those courts you can go and appeal for your cases. So in those courts you can go and appeal for your cases, and that is why these courts are known as the name of the trial courts. Okay, appellate courts, because you can appeal in these courts. Okay, so first the case goes to the lower court, then to the High Court, and then to the Supreme Court. Clear to all of you, my dear students? Can I have the answers? Please respond. Okay, now let's start with the Supreme Court of India. Let me tell you, my dear students, that the Supreme Court of India is the apex court of India and the highest court of justice in the country. The Supreme Court is the apex court of India and it is the highest court of justice in the country. And let me tell you that the Supreme Court was started on 28th January 1950. So the Supreme Court is the apex court and the highest court of justice in the country, and it was started on 28th January 1950. Now the question comes that where the Supreme Court is mentioned in the Constitution of India. So let me tell you, my dear students, that the Supreme Court is mentioned in the Part 5 of the Constitution, and article number 124 to 147 deals with the Supreme Court of India. So the Supreme Court of India is mentioned in the Part 5 of the Constitution, and article number 124 to 147 deals with the Supreme Court of India. Now the question comes that the Supreme Court of India consists of total how many judges? Let me tell you that the Supreme Court of India consists of total 31 judges, but in the last month only the law has changed, so you need to change your PDF also. Let me tell you that the Supreme Court consists of total 34 judges. Always remember that the Supreme Court consists of total 34 judges, out of which we have one Chief Justice and we have 33 other judges. So we have total 34 judges, out of which we have the one Chief Justice and we have total 33 judges. Let me tell you that when we talk about the Chief Justice, who is Chief Justice? So Chief Justice is nothing, but he is the first amongst the equals. So all are equals, but the Chief Justice is the first amongst the equal. So at present, we have total 34 judges in the Supreme Court. And let me tell you that out of this, one is Chief Justice and we have 33 other judges. Okay, it was 31. It has been increased to 34. Now the question comes that in order to increase the number of judges in the Supreme Court, who has the power? So in order to increase the number of judges in the Supreme Court, the power lies with the Parliament of India. Always remember that. The Parliament of India, it's a very important question, that the Parliament of India has the power to increase the number of the judges in the Supreme Court. Now the question comes that the judges of Supreme Court are appointed by whom? So let me tell you something very important and easy question. So when we talk about the appointment of judges of Supreme Court, so appointment of the judges of the Supreme Court, it's a very important question. So the judges of the Supreme Court are appointed by the President of India, always remember. And the judges of the Supreme Court are appointed by the President after consultation with the Prime Minister. So after the consultation with the Prime Minister, the judges of the Supreme Court are appointed by the President. So the judges of the Supreme Court are appointed by the President after the consultation with the Prime Minister of India. Okay, always remember. And now this things we're talking about the judges. Now if we talk about the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, this is a very important question. Let me tell you that for the matter of Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, also known as the Chief Justice of India, the Constitution of India says that the Chief Justice of India should be appointed by the President of India. Means the Chief Justice of India should be appointed by the President of India, and it is the discretion of the President to appoint anyone as the Chief Justice. But as you know that the President of India in our country always remains away from the disputes. And what happens that the person who is senior most always, he will be appointed as the Chief Justice by the President only. But what happened that in the year 1973, a big case happened. In the year 1973, there was a judge, his name was Justice A.N. Ray, always remember. There was a Supreme Court judge, his name was A.N. Ray, and he was the 9th senior most judge. Means there was 8 senior judges before him. So Justice A.N. Ray was the 9th senior most judge, and there were 8 senior judges ahead of Justice A.N. Ray. But it is believed that Justice A.N. Ray is considered as very close to Mrs. Indira Gandhi, and Mrs. Indira Gandhi asked the President of India, Mr. V.V. Giri, to appoint Justice A.N. Ray as the Chief Justice of India. So what happened that was Justice A.N. Ray was appointed as the Chief Justice of India in 1973. There was a big revolt against Mrs. Indira Gandhi and the President, and the judges of the Supreme Court says that we are not going to work if our junior is going to be the Chief Justice. So what happened that all the big advocates of the Supreme Court, they sue the government in a very famous case known as the Advocates on Records versus the Union of India. And in that case, in the year 1993, the Supreme Court gave a landmark judgment. And the Supreme Court says what? The Supreme Court says that the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court is appointed by the President, but he should be the senior most judge of the Supreme Court. So now the power of the President is also reduced, because the senior most judge of the Supreme Court will automatically become the Chief Justice. Whether that person is liked by the President or not, now the President cannot do anything in that matter. The senior most judge of the Supreme Court, senior in terms of experience, not in terms of age, will automatically become the Chief Justice. Always remember that. The Chief Justice of the Supreme Court is appointed by the President, but he should be the senior most judge of the Supreme Court, as it was ruled by the Supreme Court in the famous case Advocates on Records versus the Union of India in the year 1993. The Supreme Court gave a very landmark judgment in the year 1993 and said that the senior most judge of the Supreme Court will automatically become the Chief Justice. So when we talk about the judges, the judges of Supreme Court are appointed by the President after consultation with the Prime Minister, but the senior most judge of the Supreme Court will automatically become the Chief Justice, and it was decided in the year 1993 in the famous case Advocates on Records versus the Union of India in 1993. I hope it is clear to all of you. Can I have the answers, please respond? What happened? Clear? I hope it is clear. Okay. So there was a query of some students that why the class of yesterday was recorded. Actually, my dear students, I was not well yesterday to take the class, and that's why, since I was not well, I do not want that you should suffer a loss, and that is why I gave a recorded class for yesterday. Okay, got it? So don't worry. The class was recorded or live. The most important thing is that you should get everything which you have been committed from our side. Okay, clear to all of you? Now what we talk about the qualifications. So when we talk about the qualifications, that in order to become the judge of the Supreme Court, what are the qualifications? The first thing is that the person should be the citizen of India. Second thing is that he should be the judge of High Court for 5 years, or he should be the advocate of High Court for 10 years. Always remember that the person should be the judge of High Court for 5 years, or he should be the advocate of High Court for 10 years. So these are the two qualifications. First is that the person should be the citizen of India, and secondly, the person should be the judge of High Court for 5 years. If he is not the judge of High Court, then he should be the advocate of High Court for 10 years. Okay. Now when we talk about the oath, the Chief Justice and the judges of the Supreme Court takes oath in the presence of whom? So let me tell you that the Chief Justice and the judges of the Supreme Court takes oath in the presence of the President of India. So the President of India administers the oath of the Chief Justice and the other judges of the Supreme Court. What is the term of the judges of the Supreme Court? So the term of the judges of the Supreme Court is up to the age of 65. So up to the age of 65 years, the The judges of the Supreme Court can hold the post up to the age of 65 years. So up to the age of 65 years, this is the something. Now, when we talk about the salary, so when we talk about the salary of the Chief Justice, let me tell you that the salary of the Chief Justice and the salary of the other judges. So when we talk about the salary of Chief Justice and when we talk about the salary of other judges, let me tell you that the Chief Justice of India gets the monthly salary of 2,80,000 per month and other judges gets the monthly salary of 2,50,000 rupees per month. Plus we have 50% pension after retirement. This is something very important. So 50% pension after retirement they get. Okay. So this is the salary of the judges of the Supreme Court. Okay. The Chief Justice and the other judges. Now, when we talk about the resignation, the judges of the Supreme Court gives the resignation to whom? So the judges of the Supreme Court can give the resignation to the President of India. So the judges of the Supreme Court can give the resignation to the President of India. So oath and resignation, they both are administered by the President of India only. Now, when we talk about the removal of the judges of the Supreme Court, now this is something very important. So how the judges of the Supreme Court can be removed. So let me tell you that the judges of the Supreme Court can be removed by a resolution, can be removed by a resolution passed by both the houses of the parliament. So through a resolution passed by both the houses of the parliament, the judges of the Supreme Court can be removed from his post, that is the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. So the judges of the Supreme Court can be removed from his post by a resolution passed by both the houses of the parliament, that is Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. This is something very important. So if that is asked in the examination that the judges of the Supreme Court can be removed by whom? So the judges of the Supreme Court can be removed by the Parliament of India through a resolution which should be passed by both the houses of the parliament. Now the question comes that till now in the history of India, any judge of the Supreme Court has been removed or not. So let me tell you one thing very important, my dear students, that the process of removal of the judges started in India 3 times, but the process was not able to get completed. Why? Because before the process could be finished, the judges of the Supreme Court resigned. So if you resign from your post, then the process of removal will not be following you. So let me tell you that the process of removal of the judges of the Supreme Court took place in India 3 times. First was against Justice V. Ramaswamy in 1992. Who was Justice V. Ramaswamy? He was the judge of the Supreme Court of India. We have Justice Soumitra Sen in 2011. He was the judge of Calcutta High Court. So Justice Soumitra Sen was the judge of the Calcutta High Court. And then we have Justice P.D. Dinakaran in 2011. He was the judge of the Sikkim High Court. So the process of removal of the judges started in India 3 times, but it was never got completed. And now let me tell you one thing very important, that the process of removal of the judges of both Supreme Court and High Court are the same process. So always remember that the removal process of the judges of the Supreme Court, the High Court, the CAG, the Chief Election Commissioner, it is the same process. It is the same process by which the judges of the Supreme Court and the High Court can be removed. Means they can be removed by the Parliament through a resolution which should get passed by both the houses of the Parliament. I hope it is clear to all of you. Can I have the answers? Please respond. Clear. Now we have the jurisdictions of the Supreme Court. Jurisdictions means the powers of the Supreme Court. So when we talk about the powers of the Supreme Court, first we have the very important known as the original jurisdiction. Original jurisdiction. First we have a very important jurisdiction known as the original jurisdiction. It is mentioned under Article 131 of the Constitution. So original jurisdiction, what does it says? So when we talk about the original jurisdiction, let me tell you that if there is any kind of dispute between the center and the state government, if there is a dispute between center and state, if there is any kind of dispute between the state and the state government, and if there is any kind of dispute between state and the union territory government, let me tell you, any dispute between center and state, state and state, state and union territory, all these disputes can be looked after by the Supreme Court of India only. So always remember that the Supreme Court of India can look after all the dispute between the center and the state government, state and the state government, state and the union territory government. So all the disputes in the all the disputes of the center and state, as you know, a very famous dispute known as a Kaveri water dispute. The water of Kaveri is a very disputed water between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. That is a state-state dispute. You must have seen the Yamuna water dispute, that is UP, Haryana and Rajasthan. So two states are involved. And two states and one union territory of Delhi is also involved. So when there is any kind of disputes between center state, state states and state union territory, the dispute can be looked after by the Supreme Court of India, and that is known as the original jurisdiction. After original jurisdiction, we have a very important known as the advisory jurisdiction. What do you mean by the term advisory jurisdiction? It's a very easy concept, let me tell you. And the advisory jurisdiction is mentioned under article number 143 of the Constitution. Let me tell you, my dear students, if the President of India, If the President of India in any matter asks for the advice of the Supreme Court. If the President of India in any matter asks for the advice of the Supreme Court, then the Supreme Court is bound to give the advice. Let me tell you that the advice given by the Supreme Court is not binding on the President. So if the President of India asks for the advice of the Supreme Court is bound to give its advice. Although let me tell you that the advice of Supreme Court is not binding on the President, means if the President wants, he will follow. If he doesn't want, he will not follow it. What about the Center and Union Territory, Avinash Kumar? As you know that the Union Territory are the part of the central government only. So there cannot be any dispute between the Center and the Union Territory. Okay. Third, we have the revisory jurisdiction. Okay. Third, we have the revisory jurisdiction. What do you mean by the term revisory jurisdiction? Let me tell you, my dear students. Revisory jurisdiction, let me tell you that it is mentioned under Article 137. What happened that suppose the Supreme Court has given a judgment. So what happened that the judgment given by the Supreme Court is although final and it cannot be challenged in any court of law. But what happened that after giving the judgment, the Supreme Court thinks that the society has changed and there needs to be, the law needs to be changed. The Supreme Court has the power to revise its judgment in order to remove the error or in order to update it. The Supreme Court has the power to revise its judgment. As you can see that in the year 2016, the Supreme Court says that the homosexuality is illegal. The Supreme Court says that the homosexuality is illegal, but in the year 2018, after the doctor's panel of the AIIMS have submitted the report that actually homosexuality is not by chance, it's not by choice, it is by chance. It is a psychological disaster, it is a psychological disorder, and people do not have the control to be a homosexual. Means the people do not become homosexual by choice, actually it is a psychological disorder. So after listening to that, the Supreme Court, what it did, the Supreme Court revised its judgment of 2016 and made homosexuality as legal practice in India. So this is what is known as the revisory jurisdiction. Means the Supreme Court has the power to revise its judgment in order to update it or in order to remove the error which might have came while making the judgment. Okay, and fourth, we have the appellate jurisdiction. Okay, appellate jurisdiction, what do you mean by the term appellate jurisdiction? Means in which cases you have the power to appeal in the Supreme Court. And let me tell you that the appellate jurisdiction is mentioned under Article 134. So what happened that suppose the High Court has given you a punishment of 500 rupees. So you cannot go to the Supreme Court. Obviously, the Supreme Court do not have so much time to look after the dispute of 500 rupees. So what happened that in which cases you have the power to appeal in the Supreme Court? So you have the power to appeal in the Supreme Court when the High Court has given the punishment of, always remember that when the High Court has given the punishment of three types, then only you can appeal them in the Supreme Court. First is if the High Court has given the death penalty. If the High Court has given the life imprisonment, or if the High Court has given the punishment of more than 10 years. So first thing is that the High Court has given the death penalty, the High Court has given the penalty, the High Court has given the death penalty, or High Court has given the punishment of life imprisonment, or the High Court has given the punishment of more than 10 years, then the person has the right to move to the Supreme Court in that matter under Article number 12034 of the Constitution, known as the appellate jurisdiction. Okay, now always remember that the Supreme Court, in case of violation of the fundamental rights, has the power to issue five type of writs. Writs means notices. Always remember that the Supreme Court has the power to issue five type of writs in case of violation of the fundamental rights. What happened that I have taught you the fundamental rights, and suppose if there is a violation of fundamental rights, then the Supreme Court has the power to issue the writs. First is the habeas corpus. The meanings are asked in the examinations, but very rarely the question can come in the NTPC. Habeas corpus means you may have the body. You may have the body means what? If anybody has been, you may have the body. Body means the person. Suppose if anybody has been taken into custody by the police, means illegal detention. So if anybody has been taken into illegal detention by the police, then the Supreme Court can issue the habeas corpus notice against the police. Mandamus notice means to give command. What happened that you know that when any person who is quite influential and he commits a crime, then the police will not register an FIR against him because he is a very influential person. But when the people goes to the Supreme Court and says that the police is actually not registering a complaint against that person because he's a rich person or is an influential person, then the Supreme Court gives the order to the police to write a complaint against that person, and this is a command. And when this command is given, the police is bound to follow this command. Then we have क्यो वारंटो मीन्स बाई वॉट अथॉरिटी इट दिस मीन्स दैट वॉट बाई वॉट अथॉरिटी मीन्स एनी वन हु इज नॉट अथोराइज टू डू अ सर्टेन वर्क एंड इफ द पर्सन इज डूइंग दैट वर्क देन द पर्सन कैन बी रिमूव फ्रॉम हिज पोस्ट सपोज वॉट हैपन दैट आई वियर अ पुलिस यूनिफॉर्म एंड गो ऑन अ रोड एंड स्टार्ट कटिंग द चलान ऑफ द पीपल देन द क्यो वारंटो नोटिस कैन बी इशूड अगेंस्ट मी मीन्स बाई वॉट अथॉरिटी मीन्स एनी पर्सन हु डू नॉट हैव द अथॉरिटी टू डू सर्टेन वर्क And if he is doing that work, then that person can be removed from his post. By what authority? Means you are allowed to do whatsoever your orders are. Means if you are working outside your jurisdiction, then the Supreme Court can issue a writ known as the quo warranto. Now we have the certiorari and prohibition. You must know that there are some very influential people in India. And what happened that when the matter goes to the courts give the decisions under the influence of those people. And when the court gives the decision under the influence of those people, then obviously the natural justice will not take place. So when the people, the victim go to the Supreme Court that says that I have not been given justice by the court, then what happened that the Supreme Court can transfer the case from lower court to higher court after the judgment is made and putting a stay on the orders of the lower courts. So what happened that under this, the case is transferred. The case is transferred by Supreme Court from lower court to higher court, from lower court to higher court, but after the judgment is made. So after the judgment is made, the case is transferred from lower court to high court, always remember. So after the judgment is made, the case is transferred from lower court to higher court. This is the same also, the prohibition is also same. The case is transferred by the Supreme Court. The case is transferred by Supreme Court from lower court to higher court, but before the judgment is made. So if the case is transferred before the judgment is made, then it is known as prohibition. So these are the five type of writs which the Supreme Court can issue in case of violation of the fundamental rights. And these writs are issued by the Supreme Court under article number 32 of the Indian Constitution. Always remember. Okay. Clear? I hope it is clear to all of you. This ends with the Supreme Court of India. I hope it is clear. Can I have the answers? Please respond. Clear? First, when we talk about the high courts, let me tell you that. First, can I have the answers? You people respond very slowly. Okay, so please be fast while responding any query so that we can move forward. Okay. Now we have the high courts. Now let me tell you, my dear students, that the high courts are mentioned in the part 6 of the Indian Constitution. And article number 214 to 231 deals with the High Court. So the Supreme Court was mentioned in the part 5 of the Constitution, and article number 124 to 147 deals with it. In the same manner, the High Courts are mentioned in the part 6 of the Constitution, and article number 214 to 231 deals with the High Court. I hope it deals with the High Court. Let me tell you that the High Courts, it's a very easy thing, let me tell you, my dear students, that the high courts are the highest court of justice in the state. Like the Supreme Court, it is the highest court of justice in the country. The high court is the highest court of justice in the state, and it functions below the Supreme Court but above the subordinate courts. Always remember, the high court is the highest court of justice in the state, and it functions below the Supreme Court and above the high court. Now something very important, I need to tell you one thing very important. Now, there are total 29 states in India, and we have total 7 union territories in India. So 29 plus 7, we have total 36 territories in India. So obviously, we cannot make 36 high courts in India. Obviously, it will be a very tedious work because making high court is not an easy thing. Okay, so what happened that there was a law passed in India known as the 7th Amendment Act 1956. Now, let me tell you that by the 7th Amendment Act 1956, there can be a common high court. There can be a common high court for two or more than two states. There can be a common high court for two or more than two states and a union territory. So there can be a common high court for two or more than two states and union territory. Likewise, we have the Bombay High Court. Bombay High Court functions for Maharashtra, functions for Daman and Diu, Dadra Nagar Haveli, also functions for Goa. So Maharashtra, Goa, Daman and Diu, Dadra Nagar Haveli, they all are looked after by the Bombay High Court. Likewise, we have the Calcutta High Court. Calcutta High Court looks after West Bengal as well as Andaman Nicobar. Likewise, we have the Punjab and Haryana High Court. It looks after the Punjab, it looks after Haryana. Apart from that, it also looks after the Chandigarh also. So this is something very important. Okay, so my dear students, let me tell you that under the provisions of the Constitution of India, it says that the state will have the High Court. But by the 7th Amendment Act, there can be a common High Court for two or more than two states and union territories. Now, it says that at present, there are total 24 High Courts in India. Plus, do one thing, please change the data in the PDF also. At present, there are total 25 High Courts in India. And recently, the High Court has started in the year 2019. And the most recent High Court which has been started is known as the Andhra Pradesh High Court. Andhra Pradesh High Court has been started in 2019 at which place? At Amravati. So let me tell you that the number of High Courts in India has been increased from 24 to 25. The last time three High Courts were added, that is Manipur, Meghalaya and Tripura in the year 2013. Always remember that Delhi is the only Union Territory. Delhi is the only Union Territory which is having its own High Court since 1966. Apart from Delhi, no other Union Territory will have its own High Court, always remember. Apart from Delhi, no other Union Territory has its own High Court. Likewise, all the cases of Andaman Nicobar is looked after by the Calcutta High Court. The cases of the Lakshadweep is taken care by the Kerala High Court. The cases of Daman and Diu and Dadra Nagar Haveli are taken care by the Bombay High Court. The cases of the Chandigarh are looked after by Punjab and Haryana High Court. So Delhi is the only Union Territory which is having its own High Court since 1966, always remember. Let me tell you that the Calcutta High Court is the oldest High Court of India, started in 1862, followed by the Bombay and the Madras High Court. Always remember, these are very important questions. Okay, so Calcutta High Court is the oldest High Court of India, started in 1862, followed by the Bombay and the Madras High Court. So Calcutta High Court in 1862, after 2 weeks, the Bombay High Court was started, and after 2 weeks, the Madras High Court was started. So Calcutta, Bombay and Madras, all these three High Courts started in 1862. And this is the oldest High Court of India. Now, let me tell you that the High Court consists of one Chief Justice. The High Court consists of one Chief Justice and other judges. But something very important, I would like to tell you that the High Court consists of one Chief Justice and other judges. But one thing very important, I would like to say that the number of the judges in the High Court are not fixed like the Supreme Court. Means the Supreme Court was having total 34 judges, but the High Courts, the number of judges are not fixed. They can be 10, they can be 20, they can be 30, they can be 40, they can be 50, they can be 60. It depends upon the requirement of the state. Always remember. Okay, so always remember that it depends upon the requirement. Now, when we talk about the appointment of judges of High Court. Okay, when we talk about the appointment of the judges of High Court, let me tell you that this is the Chief Justice and this is the other judges. Now, the process is very simple. The Chief Justice and the other judges of the Supreme Court, of the High Court, are appointed by the President of India. They are appointed by the President of India. But let me tell you that the consultation is not with the Prime Minister, but the consultation is with the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. And the second one is the Governor of the state. So Chief Justice of the Supreme Court and the Governor of state, they both are involved. And when we talk about the other judges, we have the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. We have the Chief Justice of the High Court. And we have the other judges and we have the Governor of the state. So you can see that the consultation of the President is not with the Prime Minister, but the consultation is with the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court and the Governor of the state. In case of other judges, it consists of Chief Justice of Supreme Court, Chief Justice of High Court and the Governor of the state. So here the consultation is not with the Prime Minister. Okay. Now when we talk about the qualifications, that if you want to become a judge of the High Court, what is going to be the qualification? So qualification says that the person should be the citizen of India. The person should be the citizen of India. Secondly, the person should be the judge inside the territory of India. The person should be the judge inside the territory of India. The person should be the judge inside the territory of India for 10 years. Means the person should be the judge inside the territory of India for 10 years, or he should be the advocate of High Court for 10 years. Now this is something very important, that the person should be the judge inside the territory of India. Means he should be the only judge. Means he can be a judge of a lower court, he can be a judge of a railway court, he can be a judge of a metro court, anywhere. Means he should be the judge inside the territory of India, that's it, for 10 years, or advocate of High Court for 10 years, then the person can become the judge of the High Court. Now, when we talk about the oath, who administers the oath of the judges of the High Court? The judges of the High Court takes oath in the presence of the governor of the state. So in the presence of the governor of the state, they takes the oath. What is the term of the judges of the High Court? So the term of the judges of the High Court is up to the age of 62 years. So the judges of the High Court can remain on their post up to the age of 62 years. What is the salary of the judges of the High Court? The salary of the Chief Justice, let me tell you, my dear students, the salary of the Chief Justice is 2,50,000 rupees per month, and the salary of other judges is 2,25,000 rupees per month. Okay, so 2,50,000 and 2,25,000, plus we have 50% pension after retirement also. Okay, so the Chief Justice gets the monthly salary of 2,50,000, and other judges get the monthly salary of 2,25,000, plus he also gets the 50% pension after retirement. After that, when we talk about the resignation, that the judges of the Supreme Court can give the resignation, and this is the place where the people do biggest mistakes. There the people do the biggest mistake, because the resignation, this is something very important. The people used to say that the judges of the High Court will give the resignation to the governor, but not the true. People of the judges of the Supreme Court will going to give the resignation to the President of India, because the appointment has been done by the President. Since the appointment has been done by the President, the resignation will go to the President of India only. Always remember. And when we talk about the removal, let me tell you, my dear students, the removal process is same. That is same as the judge of the Supreme Court. So you do not have to do anything else. Okay. Naresh, it's a very easy and important question. No educational qualification. Obviously, in order to be a judge or in order to be an advocate, you have to be educated, obviously. Okay, clear. When we talk about the jurisdictions of High Court, let me tell you that the High Court, clear, looks after all the disputes of will, marriage, divorce, adoption, election of MP and MLA. So the High Court looks after all the disputes of will, marriage, divorce, adoption, election of MP and MLA. All these disputes are looked after by the state High Courts. So High Court looks after disputes of will, marriage, divorce, adoption, election of MP and MLA. So these are the disputes which are looked after by the High Court. Now the very important questions, that as I told you, that the Supreme Court has the power to issue 5 type of writs in case of violation of the fundamental rights. Parliament, obviously Amrinder Reddy in the parliament only, not in the state. Okay, as I told you, that the Supreme Court has the power to issue 5 type of writs in case of violation of the fundamental rights. But the problem, my dear student, is that the Supreme Court in India is situated in Delhi. What about those people who are living in the remote areas of Andaman Nicobar, who are living in the remote areas of Lakshadweep, who are living in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala, Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Manipur, Mizoram? Those people, if their fundamental rights are violated, how they come to the Supreme Court? Because the Delhi is very far away from those places, and people in India do not have the resources, do not have the money to come to Delhi. So in that case, how the justice is going to be prevailed for those people? So let me tell you that for that purpose, under article number 226, always remember that the High Court can issue the same writs. Always remember, the High Court can issue the same writs like the Supreme Court did under article 32. that is habeas corpus, mandamus, quo warranto, certiorari and prohibition. It is asked in the examination that which is the common power between the Supreme Court and High Court. So let me tell you that the issuing of writs is a common power between the Supreme Court and High Court. The Supreme Court issues under Article 32 and the High Court issues under Article 226. Now it is the discretion of the people that in the case of violation of the fundamental rights, they can go to the Supreme Court or they can go to the High Courts also. Means now you have the choice to decide whether to go to the Supreme Court or whether to go to the High Court. Clear, clear, clear. The High Court supervises all the courts working in the state. Always remember. The High Court supervises all the courts working in the state. Like the Supreme Court supervises all the courts working in the center, in the country, the High Court supervises all the courts working in the state. High Court is wider than Supreme Court. Yes, yes, High Court writs is wider than the Supreme Court because the Supreme Court can issue writs only in case of violation of fundamental rights. But the High Courts can issue the writs in the matters other than the violation of fundamental rights also. So this ends with your High Court. I hope it is clear to all of you. Clear, clear, clear. So we'll move to the subordinate courts. That is the lower courts. So clear to all of you, the lower courts are mentioned in the part 6 of the constitution and article number 233. So 237 deals with the High Court, deals with the subordinate courts. So the subordinate courts are mentioned in the part 6 of the constitution and article number 233 to 237 deals with it. Always remember that the subordinate courts works under the High Courts at district and the lower level. So always remember that the subordinate courts, they works at the district level, and that is why they are also known as the district courts. Let me tell you that, students, there are two types of courts. There are two types of courts in every district of India. There are two types of courts in every district of India. Always remember that any district of India, there are two types of courts. Suppose what happened that I live in a district known as the East Delhi. I live in a district known as the East Delhi. So East Delhi is the district where I live. Now there are two types of courts in the East Delhi. Okay. Let me tell you that one is known as the Civil Court and one is known as the Sessions Court. One is known as the Civil Court and one is known as the Sessions Court. Now students, let me tell you that one is Civil Court and one is Sessions Court. They do not work differently, but they work in the same compound only. Sometimes they can also work in the same room. Suppose what happened at this room where I'm sitting, it is Civil Court in the morning, it becomes a Sessions Court in the evening. Okay, so Civil Court and Sessions Court, they are two different courts, but they are working in the same compound only. And sometime when there is a place, less place, then they can work in the same room only. What are the civil courts? Civil courts are the courts where the non-criminal cases are there. So where the non-criminal cases are fight, where the non-criminal cases are fought, like the motor vehicle acts, suppose the tenants are not giving rent to the landlord. So these are called known as the civil cases. And the sessions cases, what are the sessions court? Sessions court are those courts where we fought the criminal cases. Okay. Okay. So criminal cases are in the sessions court and non-criminal cases in the civil court. Now, who is the biggest judge of the civil court? Let me tell you, the biggest judge. Can a court martial judgment? I'm really sorry, Budim. The court martial judgment cannot be challenged in the Supreme Court. The person who has been given the punishment by the court martial can go only to the President of India for the mercy. Who is the biggest judge of the civil court? So let me tell you, the biggest judge of the civil court is known by the district judge. The biggest judge of the civil court is known by the name of the district judge. And the biggest judge of the sessions court is known by the name of sessions judge. Let me tell you that the district judge and sessions judge are no different people. They are the same people. It is only the post name. Okay, suppose you go to a court and you see that a person, his name is Mr. R.K. Singh. Suppose we have a judge, his name is R.K. Singh. So you must be seeing that it is written as the district judge slash sessions judge. So the person who is a district judge is also a sessions judge at the same time. Always remember. So district judge is also the sessions judge. Means when the judge sits in the civil court, he is known by the name of district judge, and when it sits in the civil sessions court, he is known by the name of sessions judge. Who appoints the district judge or sessions judge? So let me tell you that the district judge or the sessions judge is appointed by the governor of the state. The governor of the state appoints the district judge or the sessions judge. So sessions judge or the district judge is appointed by the governor of the state. Now, the district judge cannot look after all the cases all alone. So he is assisted by two judges. One is known as the subordinate judge. One is known by the name of subordinate judge and one is known by the name of munsif judge. So munsif judge is the most junior judge. He is the senior of him and he is the district judge. So district judge is the most senior of all. Always remember. Okay. In the same manner, the sessions judge, there are two people. We have the CJM and we have the JM. JM is known as judicial magistrate. He looks after the very small cases where he can give the maximum punishment of 3 years. So the judicial magistrate cannot give the punishment of more than 3 years and the chief judicial magistrate can give the punishment up to 5 years. And above 5 years, the punishment can be given only by the sessions judge. Suppose you have committed a murder, so the case will go directly to a sessions judge because in the case of murder, the punishment will be obviously more than 5 years. Okay. So let me tell you that the district judge is same as the sessions judge. The subordinate is same as CJM and the munsif is same as JM. So the person who is a munsif judge is also a judicial magistrate. The subordinate judge is the chief judicial magistrate and the district judge is a session judge. It's only the name which changes when the person shifts from a district, from a civil court to a sessions court. I hope it is clear or not. Let me tell you, collector and SDM, they are the magistrates of the revenue courts. Means they looks only after the revenue courts, not after the civil and the sessions court. That is something different and it is not mentioned in the constitution. I hope it is clear to all of you. Clear? So let me tell you that the civil court consists of the district judge. Under him, there are two other courts known as the subordinate judge court and munsif judge court. Okay. The criminal court consists of the sessions judge. Under him, there are two other courts known as the chief judicial magistrate court and the magistrate courts. Okay. Now, let me tell you that in big metropolitan cities like Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata, Hyderabad, and Bangalore, in those cities, the district judge is known as the chief judge and the sessions judge is known by the name of metropolitan magistrate. So district judge is known by the name of chief judge and the sessions judge is known by the name of metropolitan magistrate. Budim, nothing else. Let me tell you that the district judge is a first class magistrate, the subordinate judge is second class, and the munsif judge is the third class magistrate. It is the same thing. So JM is a third class magistrate, is a second class magistrate, and is the first class magistrate. Okay. So in the big cities like Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata, Hyderabad, and Bangalore, the district judge is known by the name of chief judge, and the sessions judge is known by the name of metropolitan magistrate. So this ends with the topic of judiciary. I hope it is clear to all of you. Can I have the answers? So please respond so that I can get to know. Clear? Clear. So thank you so much for joining the class.